topic for this month, Christ Jesus is made unto us. And today we are going to deal on redemption, which we already started in the time of refreshment. Actually, I didn't even know that that was the time of refreshment team, because the time of refreshment team is supposed to be the love of God. But the redemption is also hidden in the love of God. Amen. The book of 1 Corinthians 1. Let us start from 26. 1 Corinthians 1. Let us start from 26. Yes. He said, "For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty." Amen. Amen. "And base things of the world and things which are despised, and God chooses, yes, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him are you made in Christ Jesus. But of him are you made in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord."
Yeah.
We are hearing here that it is not how wise you are, how knowledgeable you are, how full of understanding you are that God works with, but rather that which God has, how connected, how close, how you have accepted that which God has done unto you. That is why he takes the foolish things to compound the wise. Because the wise are full of knowledge, full of understanding, full of the things to do, the rightful things to do. Yet, because they don't know who Jesus is, they don't know who Christ has been made unto them to be. Christ does not, Jesus does not, God does not relate with them. So he takes, when he says he takes the foolish things of the world to compound the wise, even the foolish things of the world could be somebody who is a billionaire, who is a millionaire, who is the first richest person in the whole world, but still bow to God. Because in the eyes of everyone in his cycle, you are a fool. How can you have so much power, so much wisdom? How can you be the controller of the world? The one that once you are speaking, every government will listen to you. And yet, you bow your head to an invisible God.
Hallelujah.
You bow your knees to a name. You got an understanding. So he baffles the mind of people. So when God says he's using the foolish things of the world to compound the wise, does not mean that you are foolish. It means that those around you judge you foolish. It means that those around you don't understand what it is that is in God that you know. And that is why God wants to open our eyes to understand what Christ has been made to be unto us. Some of these things are listed here. He said Christ has been made unto us wisdom. Christ is made unto us righteousness. Christ is made unto us sanctification. And Christ is made unto us redemption. We are going to deal with redemption today. I want to start from the end before we go. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And it is in understanding what is in redemption. It is in the understanding of what is in righteousness, in sanctification. It is in the understanding what is in the wisdom that Christ has. That is how you could make even the wise one to become foolish. Because then your foolishness in the eyes of man is actually wise. Amen?
Amen.
Because you are here to defeat the one that thinks or believe he is wise or she is wise, that you don't know, but you are going to die and perish forever. That you don't know that this thing is not just talking, it is real. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. When we are talking about redeem, to redeem, we started already last week. To redeem means to deliver, to buy from the market. To buy from the market of slavery. Has Daddy already said today, the time of refreshment? Because when Adam and Eve, they committed sin, the ownership of the world was given. And when we are talking about committing sin, you know what we have read before now was talking about the flesh. It is not just this body that we carry. Remember in the definition of death, when we are talking about the penalty that follows sin, what did the Bible tells us in the book of Leviticus that we read last week? He said, the soul that sin shall die. Not the body. The soul. So it is a deeper thing than what we know. That is why those of the Old Testament, though they follow the law and they live a righteous life, they are not saved. Do you understand? Because it is a soul tie. It is an exchange of life. It is something that is deeper than the surface. Otherwise, sin wouldn't have continued. The fall wouldn't have continued. The reward, the punishment for sin wouldn't have continued after Noah. Because the Bible said that Noah was a righteous man. And Noah was delivered with his sons. But right after the flood, what happened to Noah's son? Noah got drunk. Which is what the Bible says is sin today. You can drink, he said, but don't get drunk. Noah got drunk. And when Noah got drunk, his children looked at him, the last one, and mocked the father. It shouldn't have been a sin. After all, the testament has not been written. Sin has not been written. But then Noah spoke and caused the son, and then caused this. Do you understand? Because it is a soul thing. So when we commit sin, it is not just something of the flesh. It is a soul thing. It is inside the soul. Even when your body, your flesh, your mindset is conscious of your environment and you are holding yourself not to do what is wrong, the soul has already committed sin in Adam. Do you understand? So it's an in-depth thing. That is why we all needed Christ. So when we are talking about redemption, it's deeper than even what we do today. It is deeper than the manifestations of sin. It is deeper than that. It is a soul thing. And when you understand that that soul thing has been exchanged, has been dealt with, you will know how to live the life that you ought to live now. If you don't see how much you are depraved, how much mind for the soul that sin shall die, and it says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, yet it was Adam. I think consign Adam. Eh? It was Adam, oh. But something deeper, a deeper exchange of God, that up to tomorrow, any child that is born is affected.
Yes.
And this is why I was telling them today, the time of refreshment, that the Bible said that Adam sinned and that Eve did not, because Eve was deceived. But the man that sinned actually was Adam. And I was telling them in the time of refreshment, I said, that is why God, Jesus, did not come through a man. And that was why the Jewish people could not understand the birth of Jesus. I was telling telling them it's not because Mary was a virgin and righteous. Yes, we preach that because it is part of it. But it was because there was a grace upon women.
Hallelujah.
There is grace. The grace of a woman doing wrong out of ignorance because she did not know. And so grace covered that woman. And when God came back, because even when God spoke, when he spoke in the book of Genesis 3:15, and he was saying, your seed will bruise his head, and that the seed of the serpent will what? Cut the heel. He was just looking at this woman who did not really understand the implication of sin, the damage of sin, the destruction that sin can cause. She did not understand the implication, so she did wrong. And God said, my grace cover you. And through this same woman that embraced grace, I will come to the world again. Amen.
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 So when we are talking about to redeem, which is the word agorazo, like I said, to buy in the marketplace, agorazo, to redeem. That is how that is the word that is used in the New Testament. I mean, let me bring a little bit of my theology. People now know I study now. The study of salvation, the study of soteriology. Amen. And I passed well. Praise the Lord. It's only that one cannot explain everything that you learn just once like that. So agorazo means to buy. Just as they go to the marketplace to buy the lamb that they sacrifice. And they don't just buy any kind of lamb, they buy the lamb that is without blemish, that is without stain. Amen?
Amen.
And they buy the lamb that is also exactly 1 year old. No wonder that Jesus said in the word, he said, let little children come to me, for such is the kingdom of heaven. They are clean, despite the fact that they were born into sin, but their heart does not know all these things that we bring into living, that we adults will bring into life. Look, I just put the white baby and the black baby together, they play with that problem. But let them start growing, they will start hearing stories. The same children that were so much loved, before you know, something will be in the heart of the black one against the white one, and the white one against the black one. Why? As they grow, they forgot where they come from. And then they start imagining things against each other. Jesus came to get all these things out of our head. When he says that man have sinned, he says man rejected him. From the beginning, man have done wrong. It's a soul thing, but man rejected him. Throughout the whole Testament, man was struggling. The book of Romans 3:23 is what I just said. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. From 24, he said, but being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness to the remission of sins that are past, through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say, at the time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Now, when the lamb is bought in the market, agorazo that I said, it is to buy in the marketplace. When that lamb is bought in those days, during the time of the Old Testament, that lamb will be killed. Because that lamb is without wrinkle, that lamb is without blemish. So because that lamb is righteous, because that lamb is just, once that lamb is killed, it justifies the owner and cleanses the owner and cover up. I said this already on Friday, but we're just making it a little bit deeper so that we can understand. And cover up the sins of the owner so that death will not reign. So if you look at this book of Romans that we have just read, it said we receive by faith through the propitiation, the pouring out of the blood of Jesus. That pouring out of the blood of Jesus, which is a righteous pouring out, a just pouring out, a clean pouring out, that now brought the remission of sin that are past. That is another thing. That is why when we say, can we continue to say because grace abound? What did Paul say? He said, God forbid. So if we understand the full price and the full thing that God has done, we will be running from sin. When he said in the book of Romans that sin shall not have dominion over you, yes, because that sin in the soul has been replaced with righteousness. That thing that has been here that manipulates, but we need to renew our mind. So it does not only, because he is just, he does not only justify himself, he justifies you. Ephesians 1 from 7. It says, in whom? Talking about Christ Jesus. We are talking about Christ Jesus has been made for us. By the power of his blood. He said, through faith. Bringing also the question of our brother this morning. He said, it's redemption for everyone. And the answer is that redemption is for everyone that have faith, that believes in it. Otherwise, redemption is for everyone, but you need to accept it by faith. And that is what we just read. Amen. That is what we just read in the book of Romans that we just read. Even though we are going to the book of Ephesians, in the book of Romans that we just read, I will repeat it again before I go to the book of Ephesians 25. It says, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through what? Faith. True faith in his blood. Believing that the blood has settled it. Believing that the blood has settled it. We accept it and then we are free. So it's a conscious thing that we should respond to. Amen. Amen. Ephesians 1 from 7 is repeating the same thing. Saying Christ Jesus, in whom we have redemption. Through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Not sin, of sins. Meanwhile, God was killed in Christ Jesus for that sin of the Garden of Eden. What was that sin? The sin that Satan the devil put into man, that man does not need God. Help you get what I'm just saying in a simple time. Satan the devil, according to the book of Ezekiel 18, I hope I am right. Is it Ezekiel 18 or Isaiah 18? Where he's saying that, how thou hast fallen, O Lucifer. The one that has been in the beginning. Amen. My second preacher, am I right? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Help me find Isaiah or Ezekiel is one of the two. Hallelujah. Talking about. The sinning soul shall die. Makare boshira basanda labaye. Father, we give you the glory. We give you the honor. Nana kontoro boshikere basanda liyaha. This one is still talking about the soul that died. Zaya. And I no get out for inside my. Okay, Isaiah 14. I wonder the one of Ezekiel. But Isaiah 14. I've been What is written in Ezekiel 18:20? Praise the Lord. Okay, that one, the soul that die. Okay, the soul. I want to talk about Satan. Well, I'll be about it in already in Isaiah that I opened Isaiah 14. Hallelujah. Amen. Isaiah 14 tells us 14:13. He said, "For thou hast said," and from 12, he said, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High." He said, "Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit." Now, this Lucifer that is talking about, the Bible said that he was the morning star. He was full of beauty because of what he did, because of the program. God pushed him down. Why? He did not have place for God in his heart. Pride entered his heart. And that was what he put into man through deception. That pride now came into man, that man feel that they don't need God. And because of that feeling in them, that I belief in them that they don't need God, the world was destroyed. The whole thing was now sold to Satan. Satan became the owner of everything. The only thing that amazed Satan is that why did God not kill man? For him to be the possession, the owner of the earth, the owner of the world. That is what he wanted. "You have thrown me now from heaven. Now I'm going to take over the earth." No wonder the book of Revelation said, "Woe to the earth, because Satan has been casted out to the earth." Revelation 12, I believe. Amen? Amen. But God said, "No, I created man in my image and in my likeness. I have given man the earth. Even though you have come to take it through deception, I will still give it to them, because I am God. I changed not." Thank you, Father, for confirmation. I am God. I changed not. I am not a man that I should lie. And this baffled Satan. After all, you kicked me from up. Yes, God did kick Adam and Eve, so that you can know how deep that soul that sin dies. God kicked them out of the garden and use the shadow to protect the tree of life. That if man had eaten the tree of life after man has sinned, it would have not been possible for sin to be taken away from man. But because man did not eat that tree of life, there was a chance. And that was what Satan did not know. If he had knew, when they ate that tree of good and evil, he would have carried them to the other one to eat that one immediately. Then the man would have belonged to Satan, and the earth would have belonged to Satan forever. But they did not eat that, because Satan cannot understand everything about God. So he planted pride into man. And because he put pride into man, man said, "I don't need God." But something in man started making them to be afraid. When they heard the God coming in the garden, they hid themselves, because something in them told them that this God, it is actually the Almighty God, the Omnipotent, the Omnipresent. He is the owner of this earth that we have just missed. So inside man, because God has created man in his own image, in his own likeness, there is a longing. There is a longing towards God. And that longing towards God, because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that longing towards God made it stirred up the love of God. That right there in the garden, God looked at man that was running away. He killed the lamb and covered up man. Can you imagine how much he loved you to cover up your sins? you know how much he cares for you? For him to pay the price? What price has he paid? Well, is it only one price that he paid? The price that he paid for you. It is, you, what we have just read, he said the sins. The blood paid sins. We learned last week that almost everything is purified by the blood. Almost everything. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You see, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Wherein he had abounded us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will. That will that is in his love, hebent in his love. That is why we are not destroyed. Though he chased us out of the garden, his plan is to return us back. So that tree of life is what Jesus has given. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that so ever believe in him should not perish. Should not. That one is not supposed to perish because of what God is doing. But have what? Eternal life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
He said, having made known unto us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he has proposed in himself. Just as Satan planned inside himself. He said, let me go. Let me go to the heavens. Let me take over God. Pride. Enter his head. Just as he proposed in himself. And so God also proposed. No wonder. No wonder, as wise as he said he is, he didn't know that killing Jesus is a victory for man and not for him. He thought if Jesus died, that is the end. His knowledge is so limited that he did not understand how Enoch was translated, and the Bible testified that he was a righteous one. He is so much care for God that he did not die. He did not understand. He cannot understand how Moses did not die. To the extent that in the book of Jude, he started contesting this body, now he get that. But the problem was not this flesh, not this body. The problem was that of the soul. He was fighting for material things, the body. But what God proposed in himself is that everyone that accepts this redemption, when I come back, they have a different body. But that body, every one of us will recognize it according to the book of 1 Corinthians 15. He don't understand that one. He said, because in the new life that will come, no person will be lame. No person will be deaf. No person will be blind. Even though the person died as a blind person. Even though the person died with a cancer or with whatever. He said, the new body is incorruptible. It will not affect. Satan no understands. He was contending for the body of Moses. Yet God said, you can't have the body. Let me tell you something. You know why I couldn't have the body? So that on the Transfiguration Mountain, there is a body that Moses will have to appear with. Did I say something? Come on, clap. I don't want your school for nothing. And then this will not teach me for nothing. If I give and I explore, people that clap on. No, now praise God. What's what they talk? Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That was why they didn't allow him. According to the book of Jude, the Bible says he was contending for the body of Moses. And what an angel Michael said, I rebuke you. Where was he contending? He said, this guy is in the Old Testament. He committed sin, but their hearts were righteous towards God. So when he went to the grave, after his death, Moses was part of the 500 that have a new body. They said they saw all of them. Yet the price that he paid, according to the book of Romans, he said he made them to be doing things like wrong to themselves in the book of Romans 1, because they have a depraved mind. Deprivation of mind is that mind that takes things for granted gradually. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. That one is Old Testament. That one is story. It doesn't matter. We are not in the new age. It doesn't matter. If we do this thing, no. Grace covers it. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter was the problem of the book of Corinthian churches. And that is what we are reading now as a church. If you know that you are not reading the book of 1 Corinthians, then you are calling yourself another name. If you belong to this church, you should be reading the book of 1 Corinthians now or be hearing it, audio or reading it. Otherwise, you are telling yourself that you are not part of this ministry, even though you come. Because it's disobedience. If we agree this is what we'll be doing, we should do it. Why? It is for to build us. To build us up in faith. The Bible says something. It says, obey your parents in the Lord. So when your parents in the Lord tell you do this thing, you have to do it. It builds you up. It's not something to damage you. It is something to make you to have control over your own life. And to be able to put Satan and all your enemies. Because knowledge is powerful. Amen. So he said, having made known unto us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure which he has proposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time he may gather together in one all things in Christ. So Christ has been made unto us to gather us together, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ. Hallelujah, somebody. So what has Christ redeemed us for? We have already seen all what he has redeemed us for from this book of Ephesians and that of Romans that we have read. When the first thing is that Christ redeemed us from sin, which we have already explained according to the book of Galatians 1 from 3 to 5. He said, grace be to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins. Who gave himself. So before you think of committing sin, remember, somebody gave himself. You feel give yourself for another person's sin. To some extent we do. To some extent we do. And you will cover up your brother for front of where people did. You go back, you go flogger. You have already covered it. But you went back, you tell him what you have done is not good. So as a friend, we do that because we have the image of God. That does not mean that we applause the sin. But we take that one hide and say, don't do that. That is what Jesus did for us. Is Jesus telling us that the sin that we commit is not sin? Before Satan, he said, shut up. He died himself. He said, they are all righteous. Before Satan. Then he turned to us, he said, sin no more. You said, know what he did to that woman? They brought the woman to him. He said, where are your accusers? Where are the Satan, the devil that is accusing you? Where are the people that are accusing you? Because he told the accusers, if none of you have committed sin, no, you have thrown the stone. They all went away. The woman said, none that accuses. And Jesus said, me too, I don't accuse you. But, sin no more. So before her enemies, he stood to cover up her sin. Not because he says that the sin is right, but after covering up, that is rejection. After covering up the sin, he turned to the woman and said, what you have done is wrong. Don't do it again. Do you understand? So there is this teaching that is in grace. Have paid a price for your sins. I have redeemed you from your sins, but don't do it again. So that you don't take it to be as if. I mean, if that woman now goes on to be committing sin, with that standing, if your friend, every time you are telling your friend, this is the way they do no good. This thing you are doing to your wife is not good. This thing you are doing to your husband, not to your children, not to your friends. This kind of former life is not good. And that friend refuses. And you are doing fasting and prayer for the friend, for him to change. and is resisting it. He even accuses you of being a witchcraft because he sees you in the dream. God still uses your face to warn him or her. And he sees you as a witchcraft and he continues doing something that is evil. Will you continue with that friend? You don't hate him, oh. Your mind, your spirit, you still want that friend to change. But that friend has resisted your help and insulted your friendship. So what you do is that you give gap. And that is what Jesus has done for us. This is the minimal way that I can explain it. How we are getting something. So even we, in a way, we are redeeming our friends. That is why he said, for a good man, even man can die for a good man. I do not be so in the Bible. He said, even for a good man, one will dare to die. One can dare to die even for a good man. But Jesus died not only for good men, he died for evil men. You might want to give up your life for somebody whom you know is good and is useful to the society, bodyguards. If you want to kill the president, the bodyguard will come and take the bullet. Because the president is useful to the country. So for that good man, evil human being will dare to die. But Jesus, he died not because you are good, but because while you were yet sinners, Christ died for you. And because of that, you have been bought with a price. Amen. So that you don't sin again. Amen. Thank you. So let the Holy Spirit know that you are receiving, because the teaching is not from me, it's from the Spirit of God. Let Holy Spirit know that yes, you are applauding him for what he's putting into you. Because I'm not the one, you clap your hand, no, it's not for me, that God will. So don't think that because I asked you to clap and say, now God, now they teach you, he's your teacher. I'm just the microphone. I'm the loudspeaker. Amen? So let me continue. Before time will come hit me here again. Hallelujah. That is what he said. Now I have to jump now because I get to other points. And they look the time, I know when I start. Hallelujah. 1 John 2. So, just what I've just explained, let me teach us from the word. 1 John 2 from verse 1. He said, my little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins. And not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. 1 John 1:8, he said, if we say that we have not sinned, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all righteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar. What is he saying here? He has become our advocate because he redeemed us. But if we still fall, remember the blood. Remember the price paid. And humble yourself. And then accept the Holy Ghost, who will help you to be cleansed. Christ is made unto us. What else is Christ made unto us from? According to what we have read in the book of Ephesians and Romans, he has redeemed us from all iniquity. The book of Titus 2 from 13. He said, looking to that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Amen. It takes the iniquity away. Not only the sin that Satan, the sin of disobedience, all sin is disobedience, all sin is rebellion. But not only that one, that direct instruction, but also that which could enter into us from generation. Iniquity. Also that which we program ourselves. Unto that which at times it just come around and we use it as play. He said he cleansed us. Why is he redeeming us from those iniquity? From our daily involvement of things that are not right. Just iniquity, just like Lot. The Bible said that Lot's heart was troubling him because of the sin of homosexuality that was in the Sodom and Gomorrah, because of the sin of lesbianism. He was not involved, but the thing was tormenting his heart. His eyes were seeing things that were not right. His mind could imagine what is going on, iniquity. He said, God, by his blood, redeem us from that. Why? So that he can make himself, make out of us a peculiar people, a special people for his good works. Amen. Again, he redeemed us from the curse. When sin entered, and then iniquity, how did iniquity connect to Adam and Eve? Adam, where are you? I saw you walking, I hide myself. Ken, where is your brother? Am I my brother's keeper? Iniquity. Are you getting this? Am I my brother's keeper? How are you asking me? You put up for my charge. Iniquity. Trying not to take responsibility for what we have done. We are trying to hide. You have done wrong. Instead of you to say, I'm sorry. Why did they ask me? Why are you giving me a headache about it? Am I the only one that have done something like that? Have you not seen a lot of people that have done something like that? Why is it getting you angry? Or you have done something wrong. Then you are hiding to this, putting salt into the soul. Iniquity. Hiding more to the sin. Iniquity. Malice. Unforgiveness. Carrying it up and down. Again and again, you are abusing the blood of Jesus. You don't want to let it go. Pride, and you don't know it's pride though. Unforgiveness, malice, fornication. You don't know it's pride though, because you want to be God of yourself. So people, they will come to church. You wear fine clothes, I wear fine clothes. You wear fine clothes, another person wear fine clothes. Then you enter church, you become intimidated because you are looking at another person's fine clothes. Before you know, you are looking at your head, looking at your leg. Exactly. When you look at yourself in the mirror at all, are you not the best of yourself?
Exactly.
Why should another thing be intimidating you? Before you left your home, you get the best of yourself. Stay in that confidence.
Exactly.
Don't get intimidated by any man or any woman. Why would you look at somebody? I mean, as I did now, what it concerns me concerns the thing where you bear. As I can only see what you are doing is beautiful, I'm most beautiful. Because God has made me to be like that. Do you understand? Jesus has made me to be most beautiful, to be most just the best by the power of his blood. Clap that, however, for the Holy Ghost. So you cannot intimidate me. Not besides, I can't finish now, I can't look here, I go say, hey, you see, say, what happened now?
I'll tell you.
Even if I wear jeans, I go there dance. One thing is, this is a mentality of poverty, if you don't know.
That's true.
Look at millionaires, they are wearing jeans and trousers. And no matter how much gold you put on, they know the gold inside their treasure. They are not belittled by your gold. You can pour it from your head to your leg. They know the price, the worth of who they are, the worth of what Jesus has done for us. When you know it, nothing can intimidate you. If you like, wear anything, have any knowledge, just be moving. I am a peculiar people. Look at what is written here. Serious of good works. My mind know they think nonsense. My brain know they think nonsense. I know who I am. When you know the worth of the price, you know what you have. Even if the person built three houses, you just stand your foundation now. What they concern you, concern now. Even if you don't get foundation at all, what it concerns you, only thing you know, I don't beg anybody. Okay. I am complete the way I am. Amen? So all those kind of attitude is iniquity. They are sin that you don't see. But it's in the mind. Why is it that Jesus says you that communicate, that commit fornication inside your heart? The one, what did Satan do? Is it not in his heart? He proposed. And in God's heart, God also proposed. Hallelujah. You understand what I'm saying? You do hell now, you're on fine pass. That's how it be. It made super.
Thank you.
It not concerns you. The person if you talk to you now, facing like me, I say, Richard, you for not wear these slippers now. This one are for native. Now another that it concerns you, now your leg I put on. Do you understand what I mean?
Amen.
If it is an honest one, no problem. I mean, we can correct each other. But you know the difference from honesty and the one we're saying envy. Take the talk. Because it ain't fine and it no wrong. You get this kind of slippers or you get sandals, but it no wrong. So you understand? If now the thing were wrong, then you can talk. Say, ah, this color does not match. Then that is a sincere thing.
Amen.
Not be the thing where you not be saying bad like that. You don't call everything here. Immature. But you wait and tell. Don't now, because of that, I will now start doing my club like this. We are sitting. So that nobody will now see the shoe. I'm not getting intimidated because of one person's comment. No way, rise up. I cannot bend. Jesus came to that woman in the temple. She said, how can a woman or a daughter of Abraham be bound for 18 years? He said, woman, straighten up. Hallelujah. God redeem us from the curse. Galatians 3 from 13. He said, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on the tree, that the blessings of Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Uncle, don't worry, I'm praying for you. Even if you don't need to wait because you have to go, I am praying for you, Uncle. All the prayers we will pray here, all. You have your own portion already.
Amen.
I know you need to leave. That is not a problem. God is with you. And He will continue to sustain you. He will continue to keep you. Continue to make you strong.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Is it that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith? This Spirit that we are talking about, that same Spirit that woke up Jesus Christ from the dead, is something powerful.
Oh, yes.
We don't play with the Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 1:18. It says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us that are saved, it is the power of God. It redeemed us from the curse. How did the curse came? After Adam and Eve, they committed what they committed. One, the cause of death. It was automatic. Secondly, they were driven out of their possession, out of the garden, but not out of the earth. You know, I told us that God has planted a garden for us. Every one of us will have our garden here on earth. We have our own space. They were driven from that space. But Jesus Christ took them back to their garden. Restored them back to their garden, but not to the tree of life. Because it is in Christ Jesus that the tree of life is hidden. Mankind is returned, but everyone that accepted Him will receive that eternal life that is in Christ Jesus. That tree of life that is in Christ Jesus. So death came. He said, this ground will become problem. That is a cause. Sorry. The cause came. Say this ground. It will become hard work before you eat. You see where will they go work? Where will they sweat like sweater? He said, woman, out of pain, you will give birth. Say, but in Christ, according to the book of Timothy, you shall be redeemed. Or rather, you shall be saved. So cause now entered. That struggle, because before He said, man, He has not created man to till the ground. So man was made to walk and to do good works in the garden originally. So, but now, because a curse has come, He said, the ground will not yield an increase. No wonder when Moses was now pronouncing blessing in the book of Deuteronomy 28 and in the book of Leviticus, one of the blessings that he pronounced, he said, ground, yield your increase. To reverse that course, kind of doing it little until Jesus Christ will come. And that is why you saw that when Isaac wanted to go to Egypt, God said, don't go, stay. It was during famine. The ground was not yielding. Cause is working. He said, don't go, stay. He planted. He reaped hundredfold until he became an envy. That same ground. Even if in the Old Testament, that same ground can turn around. When David counted the people, famine came. Death. God said, go to that young man. Buy the treasure, get the treasury floor, and then sacrifice. He sacrificed the that same year, according to the Bible. The ground yielded the increase. He said that same year they had an harvest. You understand what I'm saying? So now that Jesus has come, that cause of say walk like an elephant and eat like ants. I don't even know the job parts out of the tree. Walk like an elephant. We cannot be, supposed to be, no besides. I know for my house. The one where the job parts, nice sleep house inside the house. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Somebody go chop at the day I finish, go eat pizza, join up. After 1 hour, we're going to do toast bread. You go ask yourself, which belly they enter? And it be like stick. Me, I dare not if eat 1/4 of that one. I go just a balloon, they go anyhow. So at times, I don't know if it is the work like elephant. Now they make elephant, they eat like ant. I don't understand. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
We need to put the jokes at times. But even if as at that time, the mercy and the faithfulness of God turns his own course that he caused mankind because he so much loves us. How much more now that Christ has become a cause for you and I? Do you see the things that the redemption has done? Even the curse on the ground has been lifted. When that thing gets into the mentality, things will be working out for good. Once you are able to, because we receive it by faith, me that I am talking, I have to accept it and receive it by faith. Because doubt binds the mind. Well, you get it by faith. He said, when Moses was praying and speaking to the Israelites, he said the fruit of your body, of your ground, of your cattle, he said, shall be fruitful. In increase, not only you yourself, they move from your belly, they move from your ground. And it was happening in the Old Testament because Christ has been made a curse so that we cannot be under the bondage of that curse any longer. You can go home yourself and read the book of Deuteronomy 28 or Leviticus 16. Is telling us what this redemption, this blood has done. And these things, they are all not possible. Now I'm almost 1 hour. They are almost not possible. Until and because Jesus died and actually gave that blood. The book of Hebrews, now I stop here. We will continue next week. He said, where a testament is, I don't call the chapter.
No.
Hebrew 9:16-17. He said, for where a testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. For a testament is of force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all when the testator lives. That is why you see that in Old Testament, we are just enjoying the blessing little by little. Like all the examples that I have given. They were righteous people in the Old Testament. They were those that the curse never had the power over the fruit of their land in the Old Testament. There are some in the Old Testament that death did not even have power over them. He said it will not have full strength, full force, when the testator has not fully died. Jesus Christ came and he redeemed us by dying. So that now that he has died, the strength of what he has done is now released unto you and unto me. So we have that. Woo! The power to stand and receive by faith that which God has given us. May God bless you.